السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن صار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، inshallah ta'ala, my beloved brothers and sisters, today is going to be our last lesson from these classes, where we're going to be going through the lives of particular individuals from our past, just to hear their stories and how they were in terms of ilm, ibadah, so that it can be a form of aspirations for us when we want to seek knowledge as well. And so, inshallah ta'ala, today we are going to take the biography and the life of Mujahid ibn Jabrin, rahimahullah ta'ala, rahmatan wasi'an. But before I begin, I have a su'al, which is, can you all hear me? Because no one's responding to me. Can you hear me? Can I be heard? Na'am? Everyone can hear me? Aisha, Abu Ali, Rahmatullah, Ammar, Hamdan, okay, Jameen, Jazakumullahu Khair. Thank you so much. طيب, who here has heard of Mujahid before? Mujahid ibn Jabir. Who's heard of his name? Anybody heard of his name? Naam? طيب, Mujahid ibn Jabir, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, Imam al-Dhahabi, Imam al-Dhahabi. Have you heard of Imam al-Dhahabi as well? Imam al-Dhahabi, the great muhaddith, Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah ta'ala. He has a very famous kitab, okay? He has a famous kitab, and the kitab is called Siyaru A'lam al-Nubala. Okay, this is book here, Siyaru A'lam al-Nubala. It's like a 28-29 volume book, where he basically gathers and he brings together the names of Sahaba, the students of the companions, everybody from the time of the Prophet والسلام, up until the seventh century Hijriyah. So 700 years packed of men and women from our history. So in there he brings Mujahid ibn Jabir. Mujahid, he is not a companion. He is not min ashab al-Nabi. He's not from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But rather he is a tabi'i. A tabi'i. And what is the ma'na, the meaning of the term a tabi'i? A tabi'i basically means the one who followed. And it refers to the one who followed the companion. Ya'ani, anybody who met the companions and took knowledge from them, and met them in a state of iman, then that individual is referred to as a tabi'i. And so Mujahid ibn Jabrin, he is from the tabi'un. He is from those that met the Sahaba and were from the students. And Imam al-Dhahabi says his name was al-Imam al-Shaykh al-Qurra wal-Mufassireen. He says he was Shaykh al-Qurra. He was the Shaykh of the Qurra. The word al-Qurra is the plural of the word qari. Okay, when we say the word qari, right, the word qari nowadays is basically referred to يعني, someone that memorizes Quran, right, or someone that recites the Quran perhaps, but he was يعني, Shaykh al-Qurra. He was the Shaykh, the leader of all of the Qurra, one mufassirin, and the people that explain the Quran. His kunya was Abu al-Hajjaj al-Makki. Abu al-Hajjaj al-Makki al-Aswad. And he was, his name was Abu al-Hajjaj al-Makki, that was his kunya. And he was al-Aswad. And he was a black tabi'i who was a slave. He was a slave at this time. He was a slave at this time. And his name is Mujahid ibn Jabrin. He met many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and from the companions that he spent a lot of time with, a lot of time, and he benefited a lot and spent much of his time with was none other than the great, great Sahabi Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. وَعَنْهُ أَخَذَ الْقُرْآنِ. And from him he took Al-Qur'an. He took the Qur'an from him. He learned the Qur'an from him. والتفسير, and the explanation of the Qur'an. والفقه, and even fiqh he took from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We spoke about Ibn Abbas previously, and I mentioned to you all the caliber of his knowledge and how he was. And Mujahid was a student that I spent many long years with Ibn Abbas, and he took directly from him the Qur'an and the tafsir of the Qur'an and fiqh. And he also took from other companions like Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He even took from Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the mother of the believers, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and from Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas. And Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, he also took knowledge from him, wa Abdullah ibn Amr, وَإِبْنُ عُمَرْ, and from Abdullah ibn Umar as well. وَجَابِرِ ibn عَبْدِ اللَّهِ وَأَبُو سَعِيدٍ الْخُدَرِي وَأُمُّ هَانِي, and many more. And these are big names that I'm mentioning. يعني عائشة رضي الله عنها, أبو هريرة, سعد بن أبي وقاص, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, يعني جابر بن عبد الله أبو سعيد الخدري وأم هاني. Why is Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها known as the mother of the believers? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that your azwaj, يعني talking to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that your wives are the mothers of the believers. That's how Allah referred to them as. So your wives, they are the mothers of the believers. And all of the wives of the Prophet والسلام, are considered to be mothers, the mothers of the believers, and they are our mothers. Whether it's Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, whether it's Khadija, whether it's Habiba, whether it's Salama, whether it's Zainab, whichever, any Juwayriya, all of the wives of the Prophet والسلام, are considered to be our mothers. I'm going to mention to you a statement regarding Mujahid rahimahullah ta'ala, because one of the things is a statement that the Salaf they mentioned, and it's either transmitted from Sufyan al-Thawri or Sufyan ibn Uyayna, one of the two Salaf. And that is that they said that if the tafsir of Mujahid comes to you, if the tafsir, and the explanation of the Quran comes to you from Mujahid, that Mujahid said the ayah means this, then you will be sufficient. And this is sufficient for you. And the reason for that, and the reason why the Salaf they transmitted the statement from one of the Sufyans, is because of the way Mujahid, rahimahullah ta'ala, he learned the Quran. Sometimes, subhanAllah, it shocks me that a person will spend time memorizing the Quran, and once they finish memorizing the Quran, they say, Alhamdulillah, I finished the Quran. When in fact, it doesn't work like that. Even, subhanAllah, I was talking to my teacher, Sheikh Abdul Rahman, a few weeks ago, and we were talking about the issue of the Quran. And he was saying that, look, once the Quran has been memorized the first time, he said, that's not where it ends. It doesn't end here. In fact, that's the beginning of the journey. Having completed the first time was the easy part. The difficult part is now retaining that memorization and having to do yani muraja'ah and keep going over and over the Quran again and again. Ala kulli hal, Mujahid, rahimahullah ta'ala, as Imam al-Dhahibi mentioned, Mujahid said the following. Mujahid said, عَرَضْتُ الْقُرْآنِ ثَلَاثَ عَرَضَاتِ عَلَى ابْنِ عَبَاسِ. He said, I presented the Qur'an. He said, I took the Mus'haf. He said, I took the Mus'haf. And I presented it to Ibn Abbas. And I didn't just present it to him once. I didn't just give the, like, yani, open the Qur'an on him once. But I did it thalatha aradat. I did it three times. He said, Aqifuhu inda kulli ayah. He said, every ayah that we came to, Aqifuhu. He said, I stopped him. I stopped him in his ayah. Right? And he said, As'aluhu fima nazalat wa kayfa kanat. He said, and I asked him every single ayah, when did the ayah come down? Who did it come down on? What was the purpose behind it? Who was present there? What does the ayah mean? He said, every single ayah in the Quran, as I open out Ibn Abbas, I will say, what does this mean, Ibn Abbas? Who was this revealed upon? And what was the situation? What's the sabab al-Nuzul? Is there a nasikh or a mansukh for it? And then I go for the next ayah. Until I finish that, and then I did it a second time, and then I did it a third time. The Mujahid, rahimahullah ta'ala, he wanted to know the meaning of the Quran from every single angle. Every single angle. And subhanAllah, it's funny because if you think about it today, right? If today somebody hears an ayah and they're a bit confused, they'll say, Sheikh, what does this ayah mean? I'm a little bit confused. And that's where it stops at. And Mujahid was like, no, that's what the ayah means, right? When was it revealed? In the Meccan period or the Medina period? Okay, was it revealed in this situation or that situation? Was it on this battle or that battle? Who was it revealed upon? For what person? What particular issue? Okay, is there a arm or a khat? He would ask these particular questions. And that striving of wanting to be very detailed and deep in his knowledge shows to you how far he deemed himself in wanting to seek this knowledge. And for him, it wasn't that I just want the surface. I mean, some of us, we just want the surface of the Quran. I mean, I remember I went to, subhanAllah, many years ago to a lecture by an individual, and somebody said to him that, you know, I don't really like feel like memorizing the Quran. You know, I don't really have the himma aspiration. And he said to him, just touch the pages of the Mus'haf. He said, that should be sufficient for you. Why is the aspiration and the himma for a Muslim with the Quran based upon just touch the page, touch it. And what's that going to do for you? What's that going to do for you? The touching is not going to benefit you as it would if you were to read the Quran and memorize it and ponder upon it, learn the Arabic language, and etc. And because of this, and the way Mujahid strived in wanting to attain the Quran, listen to some of the statements that some of the Salaf said about him. Qatada ibn Da'amah al-Sudusi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, A'lam, he said, I know, man baqiya bit tafsiri Mujahid. Okay, he said, I know that which remains from the man baqiya bit tafsiri Mujahid, that which remains is from the tafsir of Mujahid. He said, Khusayf, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, kana Mujahid a'lama hum bit tafsiri. He said, Mujahid, he is the most knowledgeable of them when it comes to tafsir. And when you look at the tabi'een and the great tabi'een, yani Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says in a statement, he says, خُذُوا التَّفْسِيرَ مِنْ أَرْبَعَةٍ. He said, take the tafsir from four individuals. Mujahid, take it from him. وَسَعِيدُ بْنُ جُبَيْرِ, take it from him. وَعِكْرِمَةٍ, take it from him. والضحاك, and take it from him as well. And Khusayf said that from these four individuals, كَانَ مُجَاهِدْ, the Mujahid was أَعْلَمَهُمْ بِالتَّفْسِيرِ, he was the most knowledgeable of them when it came to the tafsir of the Qur'an. Ibn Jurayj, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, لِيَنْ أَكُونَ سَمِعْتُ مِنْ مُجَاهِدْ, he said, when I would hear from Mujahid the tafsir of the Quran, but I would listen to him and the tafsir that he would give the Quran, he said, I would say, سَمِعْتُ مُجَاهِدًا أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَهْلِي وَمَالِي. He said, listening and hearing from Mujahid the Quran and the tafsir of it, أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَهْلِي وَمَالِي, it is more beloved to me than my family and my wealth. And he just hearing the words that come out of the mouth of Mujahid and the way he explains the Quran and the ayat and the nasikh and the mansukh and the am and the fiqh and everything that he extracts from it, all of that is more beloved to me than my own family and my own wealth. my own wealth. يعني the قيمة of this person, this individual, the caliber of his knowledge. There is no way that he would have attained this. And for the people to be around him like this, except for the fact that he strove when it came to learning the Quran. He strove. And nowadays, subhanAllah, Quran is the last thing that we study. The Quran is the last thing, or perhaps sometimes it's not even in the minds of many people that we want to study the Quran, we want to memorize Quran. And how many people do I know that students of knowledge and the Quran is not even, يعني not even five ajza of the Quran have been done, not even five ajza. سلمة ابن كهيل. سلمة ابن كهيل رحمه الله تعالى said ما رأيت أحدا. He said, I've never met anybody يريد بهذا العلم وجه الله إلا هؤلاء. He said, I've never met anybody that intends on attaining this knowledge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, I don't know anyone that when you see them strive for this knowledge, that they're doing it for the sake of Allah, except for four individuals. Who are they? He said, so except for illa ha'ulai thalatha, except for these three people. Who? Ata. He said, Ata wa Mujahid wa Tawus. These three individuals. From theirs, Mujahid ibn Jabrid rahimahullah ta'ala. And people knew that the way he strove for his knowledge was bil ikhlas, with sincerity. And if a person does not seek that which is يعني, related to his deen, لله سبحانه وتعالى, how can a person ever attain it? How can a person ever attain it? Listen to the statement of Mujahid himself. Okay? Statement of Mujahid. He said, طلبنا هذا العلم وما لنا فيه نية. He said, we used to seek this knowledge. And Mujahid is saying this himself. He said, we used to seek this knowledge. وَمَا لَنَا فِيهِ نِيَّةً. And we didn't have for it an intention. We never used to intend. يعني we never used to intend Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly. ثُمَّ رَزَقَ اللَّهُ النِّيَّةَ بَعْدًا. And then after, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave us the correct intention after to seek it for His sake, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you find many statements of the Salaf that they would say that we used to seek knowledge لغير الله, for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they would say that knowledge فأبه, it rejected us. We weren't seeking it for Allah's sake. And that knowledge wasn't coming to us. It wasn't entering inside of us. فأبه, it rejected. Until we corrected our intentions for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wallahi, you have to understand that a imam of his caliber, and the knowledge that he attained, and the way he strove for that knowledge, for him to still question his ikhlas from the beginning, wallahi, it shows great humility inside of an individual. And one of the biggest mistakes that people have when they seek knowledge is that kibr and arrogance comes very quickly. You go to a few classes, you buy a few books, you learn a few words, ya'ni, ya'ni, and suddenly you believe you're better than others, and you believe you have more knowledge than others. And those that you may actually have more knowledge than, you start to belittle them, or you act proud about it. Wallahi, this is a disease from shaitan. Wallahi, and a person should, and إِلَى شَكَّمُ الْعَرَيْمُ, stay away from that. And العلم, the only thing that knowledge should do to you, and should do to us, is that it makes you متواضع. It makes you a person who has humility. It makes you a person who is humble. And subhanAllah, from يعني, the things which are غريب and عجيب, is, you guys know Sheikh Abd al-Rahman, right? Abd al-Rahman Hassan. You guys know him, right? Yeah? I think I asked you guys this question once as well. Okay. Sheikh Abd al-Rahman, I was with him a couple of months ago. And we were talking about the issue of, you know, one of the regrets that you have when you're seeking knowledge, that you wish you could have done better, etc. And subhanAllah, what I shocked me, I was set back. Because as I'm talking to him, and I said, Sheikh, what's Is there anything that you regret in your path and etc. from seeking knowledge? And he said, yeah. He said, one of the things that I regret the most is I regret not having had taken the Arabic language more seriously. I was so confused. I was like, what? So Sheikh, I said, your Arabic language is on another level, Allahumma barik. Like, I was like, what do you mean? He said, no. He said, I didn't give enough attention to the Arabic language. He said, I'm going to go back and I'm going to start doing my Arabic studies again properly. And it shocked me because, wallahi, if you listen to the Arabic of Sheikh Abdurrahman, for those of you, if you know Arabic, wallahi, you'll be taking away speeches. And the kalimat, and mufradat, and even his fasih. Fasih in his lugha. And he's very eloquent and clean. With words, subhanAllah, sometimes I'm like, Sheikh, I don't understand what this word means. I don't know where you get it from. But wallahi, it's humility does that. And ilm should cause a person to become more humble. Ilm should cause a person to become more humble. Even, subhanAllah, and many people, they say this, and it's just that even me, subhanAllah, like every time I go to a class and I read and I learn, or I learn this, or I learn that, and I go to this dars or that dars, one of the things that always gets to me is the fact that you realize you actually don't know, and you realize there are holes in your knowledge. One of the biggest moments that I had where I realized that, like, I've got so many holes, gaps, like, I don't know this issue, this ahkam, that hukum, this. And it was when I, it was actually last year, subhanAllah. Last year, meaning 2020, not 2019, but 2020, I was teaching a class, and there were things that I was just, people asked me questions, like, I don't know. And I realized that, subhanAllah, like, that means you have to go back to the drawing board. You need to go back to the beginning stuff again, just to fill in these gaps and strengthen yourself. Now, and so Mujahid rahimahullah ta'ala, he attained his knowledge by striving hard for it. And ثلاثة عرضات على ابن عباس, asking أقف عند كل آية, on every single ayah, what does it mean and when was it revealed, etc. And not only that, humility. Listen to what Mujahid rahimahullah ta'ala said. Mujahid said, I befriended and I accompanied Ibn Umar. He said, I accompanied Ibn Umar and I befriended him and I accompanied him. And he said, وَأَنَا أُرِيدُ and he said, I intended أَنْ أَخْدُمَهُ and he said, I intended to serve him. And Ibn Umar is the son of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. A companion, they say that he was the closest in terms of any being and talking and dressing like the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. People would see that the way he would embody himself and carry himself, he'll copy the Prophet alayhi salam in every little thing. And Ibn Umar was accompanied with Mujahid, and Mujahid said, I intended to serve. He said, I intended to serve. فَكَانَ يَخْدُمُنِي. I said, when I tried to do that, what happened was the reverse. That Ibn Umar, he ended up serving me instead. He said, I went because he's a man of knowledge. He's a companion. I want to serve him. I want to carry his books for him, pour his drink for him, be around him so I can take care of his needs so I can attain that knowledge. And in trying to do so, he, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was serving me instead. And this is also, subhanAllah, one of the most beautiful things that you see from the ulama. And min ahlil ilm, there are those people that, subhanAllah, they'll shock you. They're a person old in age, and he's kabir fil ilm, high, huge amount of knowledge, like a jabal. And you go to meet them, and subhanAllah, the way they serve you. I remember I went in Mecca once. We went to the house of Sheikh Yahya al-Hujuri, hafidhahu Allah ta'ala. We went to his house, and I heard he was there. We met with some of the brothers and said to give him salam, and he takes the siha regarding the da'wah in the UK. And in that, subhanAllah, when we came, he was like, no, no, he's like, no, no talking, please. He's like, let me serve you all drinks. And he just started to pour us drinks, started to pour us some juice. And he said, I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to answer questions until you drink and you've quenched your thirst and you're, and I know that you guys are okay. I said, well, I'm shocked, mother, subhanAllah. Ana kulli hal. This is the likes of Mujahid, rahimahullah ta'ala. A very powerful statement of Mujahid that I want to mention, inshallah ta'ala, which is a very, very powerful statement, which is, and in Mujahid, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, as Imam al-Dhahabi mentions in the Kitab Siyaru ala Manubala, he says, ma adri. He said, ma adri. He said, I don't know. I don't know. Ayyu ni'mataini a'zam. He said, I don't know which of the two blessings are the greatest. Which is greater? I got two blessings, but I don't know which one's better. I'm confused. And then he mentions what they are. He said, anhadaniya lil Islam. He said, the fact that I was guided to Islam, that was a blessing. That's the greatest blessing, that I was guided to al-Islam. Or, he says, أو عافاني من هذه الأهواء. Or, that I was protected. That I was protected from these أهواء, these desires. So I don't know. I've got two blessings. And in ni'mat al-Islam, the blessing of Islam, and the عافية من هذه الأهواء. And the safety and the protection from any of these desires. And I don't know which of the two is the greater blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have a question for you all. Is what do you believe? What do you think is the greater blessing? So, I need to be protected from any desires or to have been guided to al-Islam? To be guided to Islam, no? Islam, okay. Imam al-Dhahabi, pay attention to this. As soon as he brings the statement of Mujahid, he mentions and he explains what does he mean by al-ahwa, by desires. He says, قُلْتُ مِثْلُ الرَّفْضِ وَالْقَدَرِ وَالْتَجَهُمِ. He said, for example, الرَّفْض. الرَّفْض, يعني referring to any rafida, referring to the Shia. He said, for example, Allah protected him from al-rafd, يعني from Shiz. Wal-qadr, meaning the belief of the qadariya, يعني a deviant sect who do not believe in the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal-tajahumi, and the belief of the jahmiya, the belief of the jahmiya, which are also a deviant sect that are misguided. And so what he means here, in other words, is that I don't know which blessing is better. The fact that Allah guided me to Islam, or that Allah protected me from any innovation. Allah protected me from innovation, any arraft, wal-tajahum, wal-qadariya, any all of that is, any bid'ah, kufriyat, and it's all misguidance. And so in other words, what we understand from the statement of Mujahid is that if you are protected from innovation, if you're protected from innovation, that means you are guided to the sunnah. If you're protected from bid'ah, it means you're guided to the sunnah. Araft? Araftum? Halantum ma'i? And if you're protected from bid'ah, that means you are guided to a sunnah. Any araft? Any fahimtum? All of you? You're with me, right? طيب. So in other words, when Mujahid ibn Jabr rahimahullah ta'ala is saying that I don't know which blessing is any better. The fact that Allah guided me to Islam, or the fact that Allah guided me to the sunnah. Because there are many people out there that are Muslims. Huge number of Muslims. The Prophet said, ستفترق أمتي على ثلاثة على ثلاثة وسبعين فرقة. That my ummah is going to divide into 73 sects. كلهم في النار. And all of them are going to be in hellfire. إلا واحد, except for one. So a person can be a Muslim, but that doesn't mean that they're protected from innovation. But he says, I don't know which one's better. The fact that Allah had guided me to Islam and that Allah guided me to the path of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, and protected me from يعني, al-bid'ah. Wal-bid'ah. And it's true, Allah. If you actually sit down, you ponder, and you think to yourself, subhanAllah, يعني, the brother on the opposite street, he's a Muslim, but he makes and he celebrates the Prophet's birthday. And he celebrates the Prophet's birthday. And that person over there, she's a Muslim, but she's confused. She thinks Iman is only in her heart and Iman is not on her tongue. And it's like, subhanAllah, like being protected from that is also another blessing in and of itself. In and of itself. وَلَا شَكْ وَلَا رَيْبِ. If a person is guided to Al-Islam, and Al-Islam al-Sahih, then a person is also guided to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah ta'ala to give us istiqamah and to protect us from falling into that which is displeasing to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll end off by mentioning again the statement of يعني Mujahid ibn Jabrin. Mujahid ibn Jabrin, which I mentioned earlier, but and there's an extra, another narration with more wording to it. In which Mujahid says, عرضت القرآن على ابن عباس ثلاث عرضات أقفه عند كل آية أسأله فيما نزلت وكيف كانت. He said that I presented the Quran upon Ibn Abbas ثلاث عرضات three times. And every time I stopped on every single ayah, and I asked him, "Fi ma nazalat?" For what reason was it revealed? Okay, for canon. I asked him all these questions, and that is how I was able to attain this knowledge. And hard work, my brothers and sisters, hard work is what allows you to understand and gain this knowledge. And if a person is not ready to put in hard work, my teacher would always say to me, Sheikh Abdul Rahman, Sa'ad, you have to put in hard work when it comes to seeking knowledge. I said, what does that mean? He says, you study when the people are resting. When the people are resting, that's when you study. I.e. what he means by that is when the people are sleeping, you're up. The time when the people are wasting, you're up. The time when the people are enjoying themselves, you're up. And you're learning about Allah and His Messenger. That's the only way that is possible. That's the only way that is possible. And a person, and Yahya ibn Abi Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, he would say, لَن تَنَالُ الْعِلْمَ بِرَاحَةِ الْجَسَدِ. That you're not going to attain this knowledge, and بِرَاحَةِ الْجَسَدِ, and with a relaxed body. Relaxation and ease and comfort, it's not going to happen. You've got to strive, struggle, in order to attain that knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa hadha al-deen. And inshallah ta'ala, I will end it here. Anything which I said which was wrong or incorrect, then it is from me and shaitan. And Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.